Had the largest panel submission of the year. Also, I think half the panel is technically Shmoo. So this seemed like a pretty low-risk maneuver as far as half awake on a Sunday afternoon on how to do this. So I'm sure you all know what the CGC is and all that, and I'll let them dive into details. But I'm really excited about this panel. They're clearly excited about the panel. Perfect. All right. Without further ado, I'll turn it over.
All right, well, Kai passes out some of the freebies. You have other freebies. I think the intention is with the good questions, you might get some of these other things. Let's start off with one of those horrible, like, unscientific statistic representations. Like, how many people in the audience have heard of the Department of Defense? Right? Okay, that's pretty good, hopeful. How many people have heard of DARPA, right? Advanced Research Projects, right? And in the CGC program, pretty recent, Cyber Grand Challenge, yeah, the hands are starting to diminish a bit. And how many people know that the CGC had a final event, or a CFE, right? And how many people were there at CFE? All right, so great. All of the hands that are still up, if you didn't get a good souvenir from CFE, come see me afterward, and we'll see if we can remedy that. So today, headlines are riddled with emotional components, right? Like, there's not a lot of fact, there's a lot of emotion-based things. You see a lot of things about zero-day nation-state attacks, breaches with unknown ramifications. I mean, I guess, to be honest, today it's all election and political stuff, but, like, aside the proverbial today, it's all this emotional-based stuff in tech. But in any case, time has proven that societally, as software, we're pretty good at developing imperfect software, right? Imperfections in software take many forms. Some of them are subtle, some are obvious, some of them are incredibly complex, and some are very simple. But today, you can almost play year-round in this competitive circuit in the cybersecurity space for capture the flag. And arguably, the highest level of competition in this circuit is DEF CON's Capture the Flag, considered to be the most elite. And in order to get the most worthy competitors, they actually pre-qualify winners of other deemed worthy flags and competitions in that circuit. And they also hold an open qualifier, just in a bid to get the best competitors at this pinnacle game. And in these games, teams are typically pitted against each other to run known vulnerable software, and they simultaneously attempt to protect data on their own machines with this vulnerable software while manipulating protected data on opponent machines. So why am I talking about all this? Well, to sum it down into an essence, and I think something pretty close to this phrase was actually uttered at this conference a couple of years ago, but could a purpose-built supercomputer actually participate in this DEF CON CTF style game, right? So this autonomous computer would have to effectively analyze novel software, find vulnerabilities, possibly create patches, mitigations, prove the continued existence of vulnerability in opponent software. I mean, these are things, the solving, fuzzing, disassembly, automatic exploit generation, and so on. So all of the bullets that are listed on the slides are ultimately measures of how an automated machine might participate in this challenge. And if you are demonstrate excellence in many of the areas, you might perform well on the challenge. So this wasn't just a one-day event. From design and implementation perspective, this is a more than a three-year effort where fundamental architecture and design decisions were made more than 3 years ago. So this is hundreds of people contributing to this project in various different ways and capacities. From a competitor perspective, there were 104 teams that officially threw their hat in the ring. And ultimately, this was whittled down to 7 finalists this past summer. Another thing to note from the slides are going to be information dense and available. We'll try and get through it quickly to give you a foundation so that we can maybe get to some better formulated questions for everybody. But one takeaway from this is that there are largely two components. There was a qualification phase and then a finals phase, where the process of whittling down to the final seven. And we'll talk, inform you briefly about those two. So in the qualifier phase, the intention was for this to somewhat be a halfway point, encouraging development of the reasoning systems to show that they had sort of made progress and weren't delaying all of the engineering and the science effort towards the end. This was done remotely, and teams were achieving just basic capabilities in analysis and reasoning and ideally in autonomy. So from a competitor perspective, this was on a 24-hour period, had 131 challenge sets. Challenge set is sort of a self-contained package of vulnerable software. It's a unit of measure for the competition. And after quals, sort of approaching the finals event, there was a period of sparring or trials where a simulator was made available that pretended to be multiple opponents. So in addition to seeing sort of this artificial reasoning that competitors could individually compete against, it was also an opportunity for competitors to actually interact with the actual infrastructure that we were going to use for finals. So things like performance measurements and making sure that they were interacting with the API the real API on the real hardware was a huge opportunity for the competitors. So this is also another nudge towards autonomy and an opportunity to demonstrate API compatibility. So moving towards the final event, held in conjunction with DEF CON, this is an on-premise event. All the CRSs at this point had to do everything, and they had to do it by themselves on stage. So this is a competition where the competitors are machines acting without any further human interaction. So the machines are all pitted against each other, and for those familiar with the CTF space, perhaps something that's unusual is the entire game was brokered, meaning that they didn't sort of connect and interact directly with their opponents. They submitted things to the competition framework, which then performed actions on their behalf, and we'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. So 82 challenges over about 9 hours live action against the seven machines. So again, from an infrastructure perspective, there were six dedicated machines. Four of them are sort of pertinent and worth talking about a little bit more. Perhaps it makes sense to talk about those in a more graphical setting. So there's a polar. The polar's mission is to represent users. So this is functionality tests that come from external from where this vulnerable software is running to make sure that it has all the functionality it's supposed to. Very similar, there's a POV machine, but the POV machine is proving vulnerability. So this is where the opponents are fielding software to try and prove that the software on the defended host is still vulnerable. The defended host on the other side is where all this vulnerable software runs. And then in the middle, there's a network appliance, which every connection from the polar and the POV must traverse the network appliance. And there's an opportunity to put network countermeasures, or IDS rules, in the middle. So the IDS has sockets on both sides. And every time data is written to one of those sockets, it's also mirrored out to the CRS via a tap. So this is sort of an application layer tap, where there's no layer 2, layer 3. None of the streams reassembly stuff for the competitors to have to deal with, just the application layer stuff. So that's one connection that a CRS gets on one Ethernet cable. The second Ethernet cable is just a HTTP API lightweight server. And those are the only two interfaces that the autonomous system has into the game, into the final event. And most of these gray boxes can be manipulated by a CRS, not the polls, but the IDS rules. The vulnerable software can be reformulated and replaced, and the POVs are clearly provided by the competing computers. So there's two types of POVs, ways to prove vulnerability. Type one is control of EIP and negotiated bits of a negotiated register. So perhaps a way to think about this is an analog to the CTF world, where the infrastructure could immediately observe that control had been granted due to the POV. So this might be like a defacement in classic terms. Type two is reading bytes from a negotiated address in memory. Perhaps the analog to this is theft of protected information, which then the stealer, the thief, can provide and prove that they were able to obtain it. So there's early design goals with the high-level bullets here. Computers and networks don't necessarily make many of these high-level design objectives easy, as Kaz has told me time and time again, because TCP. So the determinism is a challenging road to go up, especially when you held yourselves at a high bar like we did for this competition. So it's worth spending just a brief amount of time on each one of these. So there's this notion of, and I've lost my slides. There's this notion of desiring repeatability and a notion of transparency, where we want anybody to be able to recreate the results that were recorded and ultimately used to award prizes this past summer. And I'm going to go through these last few pretty quickly so that we can get to questions. And these are most, these things towards the end are the things that people here are very excited about to answer the questions and to clarify. The next piece is a high integrity, and this is worth spending a little bit of time because there's a significant amount of prize money, like, just due to personality. Like everybody up here, most of the people in the room have a desire for high integrity in events like this. But furthermore, there was a huge prize pool, and this prize pool is being awarded by the U.S. government, right? So there's like a high level of responsibility here and a desire for high integrity, and this manifests in different ways. One way is through the enforcement of a physical air gap. So in CFE, everything was on stage, but the stage was physically air gapped from everything else after a certain point in time prior to the competition. And the only things that traversed the air gap were power and water. And the water was used for cooling, and the water cooled racks just due to the environment, right? To the point where none of us, this is the competition framework team, but this is also 6/8 of the referees that actually ran CFE in Vegas. And referees were not allowed to bring in laptops that had Bluetooth or Wi-Fi cards or cell phones or anything like that. What's the next piece? Sorry. Decree was the system that everything was running inside. Decree was restricted in several different ways. One way was taking the average amount of system calls in an operating system today, hundreds, right, and reducing that down to 7. And that had two sort of effects. One effect is it scopes the analysis that the competitors are actually dealing with, right, focusing them on what was considered to be the core fundamental problems. But also from a risk reduction perspective, that means that we're only dealing with a very limited interface on an infrastructure side, and it helps us reduce risk from an integrity perspective. So that was done both at the syscall interface layer and also as a file format, where we're not dealing with all these esoteric edge cases of ELF file formats and things like that. Also, everything that was released publicly, both for educational purposes and as training and instruction for the competitors, was all done as a 32-bit Linux operating system. However, internally, everything was running on 64-bit FreeBSD. Now, depending on your familiarity with how CTFs generally work and CGC, think about the level of effort and what would be taken to have those two systems appear to be the same and have the same measurements and have no divergence in behavior with respect to any of the challenge sets that were running, which was the bar that had to be set, right? There had to be no measurable difference between the two from the competition perspective. And then we have a forensics component. We're accepting these basically arbitrary inputs. We've limited our surface down to the 7 system calls and so forth, but we're still getting software directly from competing machines that were designed by hackers and engineers and the best of industry and the best of education. So we have a whole entire system of forensics designed on full system emulation that was analyzing these inputs that were coming from the competitors, and I'm sure that questions would be welcomed on this as well. And we have this notion of creating, we have this high bar that we're setting for ourselves and all of the data collection and the measurements. So we want this corpus to be available for the advancement of science and engineering for years to come. And with that, I'd like to get pretty close to questions to give a brief introduction to the panel. These are the cards that were presented or were displayed at the final event. Many teams worked on this, hundreds of people in various different capacities. We have teams for dedicated to visualization, dedicated to logistics, to managing the competitors' HPC gear and so forth. Two teams were fundamentally required for the CFE event to actually happen. Like if there were no cameras and it was like done in a closet, there's still two teams required. One team is typically referred as the CB authors. They created all of the challenges, and there's like a whole other talk that could be done about that. And the other team is the competition framework team, which did all of the infrastructure and the orchestration and the scoring and such, and that's the team that's here up on stage. So I'm Tim. I'm the dev team lead for the competition framework team. Brian, you want to, I don't know, like waves people in the yard, but so that's Brian, Kaz. I've basically personally heard senior government officials refer to him as the inventor of the network IDS. So like this is a bit of background here. For CFE, he was responsible for orchestration and scoring. He did lots of other things throughout the program, but that was sort of the CFE hat that he wore. Chris Eagle literally wrote the book on IDA Pro. There might be empirical evidence in front of him. And he has basically like an addiction problem with capture the flag exercises and competitions. For CGC, I think their hat he wore most days was chief architect. Holt Sorenson, for CFE, primarily automation and ops. Making all the things talk the way that they're supposed to and keeping things running. And the four of us sort of round out a group that was the School of Root hacking team years ago, a few less years ago, where DD Tech running the DEF CON CTF, and we're all members of the Shmoo group. Jason Wright, down there, he's been a SCADA ICS OpenBSD hacker for quite some time. And the hat he wore for CGC was primarily kernel hacker. And as of a few minutes ago, we know that's not just one kernel. That's arguably three. It's at least two kernels and a hypervisor.
Three hypervisors, two kernels.
Yeah. resident kernel hacker it might be the hat that he wears. And it's worth noting that in addition to the four of us, Jason also has a CTF black badge from DEF CON, although he earned it. A slightly different path. And then rounding out the panel, Mike Thompson. He's previously been the lead of cybersecurity education software, like Cyber Siege. And for those in the audience that know things about common criteria or even things like Orange Book and Red Book sort of days, was part of the design build team trying to get an A1 system going at Gemini or Gemsauce. And with that, we have things that we can talk about, but we'd rather know what you guys are interested in hearing about. Are there questions? Yeah. Are we, do we have to, you can just say it. There's a microphone there if people want to make a line.
Was there anything like that completely surprised you guys that was unexpected during the competition?
The question is, did anything completely surprise us during the competition? So CFE surprises, I guess. Everyone take it?
Surprised how smoothly it went?
And
if you know DD Tech CTFs, then yes, you were surprised how smoothly it went.
Oh, then it started on time.
Yeah, and it started exactly on time, which is a first for us.
I think interesting things. So I was surprised personally how quickly the first POVs were fielded, you know, from the start of the event till the machines actually started finding and proving vulnerabilities. And it wasn't just one machine. We had several machines in very quickly. And that was impressive.
Yeah, and then in the competition, we had all seven teams solved unique challenges. So they found vulnerabilities, and they were able to build a proof to prove these vulnerabilities existed. And all seven teams were able to patch bugs autonomously. So on software they'd never seen before, that had never been ever released before. So this was not like downloading and analyzing Internet Explorer. This was all custom-built software that no one had ever analyzed before. So no human had looked at this. It was all done completely autonomously. And that the fact that they were able to do that successfully, fully autonomously, and all seven teams did it was pretty impressive.
Yeah, I thought that was interesting. All seven teams, all seven computers were had some functionality throughout the whole game. Now, there were some hiccups that the teams sort of identified and looked at in postmortem, but none of the computers sort of like didn't function or had no autonomy at the beginning. So that's like a feat in and of itself. There were some things like it's a water cooled system, right? And so amazing amount of redundancy was put into all of the infrastructure, and one of the water pumps failed of two. In the middle of the competition, so it's a testament to trying to think of like all of the ways and in a way like red teaming the infrastructure, right? So we had a one of two water pumps fail, and the competition continued and went right on time, right on schedule.
So what was the process used for writing the challenge sets? So. This team only wrote a small number of challenge sets. Most of them were for reference to show what could be done with inside of the framework that we built. The primary goal that we gave the challenge binary authors was to separate the teams, to show like the differences of the capabilities, and they were graded on how well they were able to differentiate the different teams. We asked them to build C or C++ only challenges. They had to be pure source code so they could be recompiled. In fact, if you look at Trail of Bits, they've recently ported those to other operating systems. So you don't have to just run them in Decree. You can run them in Linux. Some of them have been ported to run in Windows. We also made them, each of the challenge binary authors, make their POVs reliable. They had to work over and over and over again through varying degrees of TCP unreliability tests.
Yeah, no.
None of ours.
Right, and no inline assembly, no writing directly machine code and jumping to it.
Also, no reuse of any existing code, right? So your protocol code, so the heap implementations, while there may have been a malloc and a free in there, they weren't any standard implementation I've ever seen. So when these were dropping, the CRSs couldn't model known heap implementations and walk into the competition with that model in the bank, right? They had to deduce the behavior of these heap implementations on the fly at CFE.
And not only did we require the challenge binary authors to do all of this, they also had to prove that the vulnerabilities could be patched and all of their unit tests still work.
Who asked? Where's that guy asked? Come on, get a book.
Auto patching and all the other work that made the competition so interesting seems to prevent its use in actual production systems, especially in critical systems.
So there's so to repeat the early part of the question, how do we see CGC being used with inside like going forward as a defensive tool? So there's a handful of things that have come out already. So a number of the competitors have already started releasing the tools that they built. Doing autonomous discovery of vulnerabilities. There's been a number of releases on automatic patching of vulnerabilities. So if you think, and not just via software, but via binaries, if you think about the fact that we have infrastructure that people have been working on for the last 30 years, and many of those companies that built that software, like the software that runs these elevators, they probably don't even have the source code for that anymore. A lot of these tools could be extended to analyze those things and then fix those bugs without ever having to recompile them.
And I mean, not to go too down the rabbit hole, but one way you can look at this is you can roughly divide it into two different classes. There's like precision patching, right? Like it goes right around the vulnerability. It fixes the actual vulnerability. You could do that in code. You could do that with, you know, like playing a trick with the stack right around the vulnerability, whatever, right? Very precision. And there's also more of like a blanket defense, which might be a mechanism like ASLR or something where we don't know where the vulnerabilities are, but we're going to try and mitigate the risk in some other way. And we saw both classes of protections deployed sort of throughout the program. So we saw it in qualification and trials and also all the way in the final event. So sort of trying, we're seeing advances in both areas, I guess is what I'm saying.
Did you come get a book?
Hi. So one of the critical design decisions that, from my perspective, I see as making the problem of automated CTF tractable is the very limited decree syscall interface, right? We only have 7 syscalls available to programs so that implementers of analysis tools don't have to go down, you know, write hooks for hundreds of different syscalls and, you know, remember the behavior that, to model them. Can you comment on the design decision to use the full x86 instruction set, which seems to have, you know, quite a lot of instructions as well, and whether or not that complexity was a challenge for players or teams?
I think that at least myself felt that the models available prior to the competition for the x86 instruction set, the semantics and the ability to semantically lift instructions into any kind of intermediate representation were fairly mature. And so we didn't feel like the competitors were going to have to do a lot of additional work to do that. We did not want them, and we felt it was counter to the productivity of the competitors to have to then model all of the system calls in whatever the chosen operating system was. So we scoped it specifically so they could get on with their work, and that work being attempting to find flaws and mitigate the flaws in software. And we tried to take some things off the table to reduce the amount of work they'd have to do to advance the state of the art there.
Yeah, in fact, between the very first release of Decree and then very shortly afterwards, we switched our compiler built in for the challenge binary authors from GCC to Clang, because we knew there were a number of publicly available from Clang to the Clang's IR lifters, such that we could reduce the amount of effort required from the competitors. So come get a book.
How many zero-day vulnerabilities were found by the CRS systems as opposed to the expected known vulnerabilities in the challenge binaries?
The unintended vulnerabilities. In our qualifying event, we had something like 70. So we had 131 challenges in the qualifying event, and there were 70 unintended bugs. So if you think about that, like, we had our challenge binary authors build purpose-built software, and they put known, like, they intended bugs to put in there, and there were accidental bugs in there. And so there were more than 70 of them in CQE, and then during CFE.
Do you remember the numbers, Thompson?
Yeah. 4 different unintended POVs or vulnerabilities in CFE.
Yeah, so for those on the streaming, we had 4 unintended ones in CFE.
And that was out of 82 different services.
Yeah, there was 82 challenges that were fielded during the day in CFE. Of the 82 challenges, POVs were proved against 20 of those challenge sets, and amongst that, then 4 of those were unintended, unknown to the POV authors prior to the competition.
Come get a book.
Hey, so among the classes of mitigations and actual point patches, which strategy proved to be more effective? The ASLR DEP style of mitigation of exploitation of the vulnerabilities or point fixes? That's question one. Question two is, I've been here for a while on this line. Question two is, I don't have room in my suitcase for any books, so I'm just going to ask 2 questions, maybe 3. second question is, of the strategies of fast patching versus a little bit slower, was the fastest patching team the one that won, or was it one that had a little bit more intelligence in the upkeep or uptime of the functionality? Maybe I have one more question, but I'll give you a chance to answer those too.
I can address the last question. The teams that were more deliberate about their patching took their time and was careful about not just patching everything that popped up seemed to do better. Some of the teams were really quick on the draw patching, and it was to their detriment because they ended up repatching and repatching, and I'm still trying to sort out why that kept happening.
There was a cost associated with patching. So if you deploy a mitigated binary into the game, then the associated service for that binary was going to be down in the next round. So you would take an availability hit for patching. So if you were very aggressive, you may in fact patch it, but you're going to lose some service availability. There's lots of game theory, you've got strategies you could have employed. You might have waited until you thought you got popped to deploy your patch. You might never get popped, right? In which case you never pay the performance hit. Right? So some of that factored into why people might have patched earlier or later.
That is my third question then. Were all of the items that were exploitable, were they all universally exploited at roughly the same rate, or was there an exploitability issue that factored in? And that's my last question, I promise.
So to answer that specific question, only 20 of the 80-something challenges were exploited. And the vulnerabilities that were proven were all over the board. They were all memory corruption bugs, but which specific ones, they were over the board.
So is there a plan to go ahead with CGC2?
I get to answer this one? There seems to be a lot of interest in sort of what's next, whether that's actually coined CGC2 or something else, whether that's run in government or in industry, or if it's a national or international, just what's next in the space. And a lot of people sort of look towards similar fields, right? If you look in the chess space, which I know that some people like to draw analogs to. It was all human versus human, and then there was computer versus computer, and then there's human-computer hybrids, and there's sort of different classes of competition. And I think one thing that many people involved in this program hope is that this is going to sort of be the advent of a new age in several fields, right? So, like, you can take any particular component. All of the CRSs used, if you were to look at it as a composability problem, somewhat similar components, right? Like, they all had some sort of fuzzer. There's like some sort of patching engine or whatever. So each one of those is like a distinct field that has academic conferences and workshops like devoted to those fields. So we hope that we push those forward sort of independently. We also have the notion of composing all of those as a mechanism of reasoning, and we hope to push that forward. And it's a little unclear exactly how that's going to shape up, if the CTF circuit, so to speak, will change and morph. And we do see sort of onesie twosie CGC specific decree challenges in CTFs already in the past years. But will people actually be fielding, autonomous systems or hybrid systems? That remains to be seen. Another data point that's perhaps interesting is the winner of CFE was granted a seat at the CFE table, or sorry, at the DEF CON CTF table this year. So it more or less competed autonomously. There were some sort of connection API sort of issues, but the humans that were helping were really just doing some translation. So it was the reasoning was done all by the computer. And then the third place team in the Cyber Grand Challenge was allowed to utilize their reasoning system. And they had also, as humans, qualified for the DEF CON event as well. So they were able to operate as a hybrid team. So you can look at the results of the DEF CON CTF and see how they placed and where the current state of the art is. And there's data that can push some of that forward. So I know it's a bit of a side answer that remains to be seen, but there's a lot of potential for future work. Yeah. So.
Come get a book.
So I think that now you've laid out the framework for how to do this. It's obviously going to happen a lot, and I think you're going to get pulled back in a lot. But in the future, how would you change the attack surface, or are you concerned, if you already think you might do it again, are you concerned with people just gaming the scoring and those sorts of long-term tractability of this sort of thing?
Yeah,
Personally, I don't think the scoring was terribly easy to game. I think that we spent a lot of time thinking about how we were going to score the competition precisely for that reason. We didn't want somebody to back their way into the prize money. We wanted them to demonstrate technical competence. Lined up with, you know, what might CGC2 look like, if I were to think about expanding the attack surface, I would expand it in such a way that it helped us introduce new technical complexities into the game. And so one of the questions that we have and why we're spending a lot of time looking at the event data in some, let's call it post-mortem sense, is what was achieved? Where did they advance the state of the art? We don't have perfect visibility into the capabilities of the CRSs because a lot of that technology resides with the competitors. We only have visibility into what they submitted into the game and what we saw there. So in some sense, we're trying to reverse engineer, you know, how good were these things really? We'll see a lot of academic papers coming out of the competitors where they're going to make claims about how good their things are. We may be able to verify that with what we've seen. But this competition was primarily oriented at memory corruption flaws, and there are plenty of other types of flaws out there. So, you know, a future iteration might involve expanding the number of bug classes that we ask the competitors to look at, and then we would probably introduce or expand perhaps a system call set, the attack surface, to support implementing challenge binaries that we're able to demonstrate or in which these bug classes could be implemented.
So come get a book. So we did add one thing that would probably get expanded. So very early on, we added this a very limited version of IPC, so inter-process communication, done via a socket interface. So some amount of, so the modern exploitation, modern vulnerability discovery, and modern patching, you know, so thread is a big complex problem. So that'd be another surface area that would be interesting to explore.
So my question is part of a two-part question. Do you see the results from this competition kind of used as a catch-all from the developers? Or is this type of technology something that can be ported to be used on source code rather than compiled executables? And what are the advantages and disadvantages of that approach?
That's a great question.
Yeah, so a program existed already for looking at finding and fixing vulnerabilities in source code. So IARPA, so the intelligence community version of DARPA, did a program focused on source code called Stone Soup. And a lot of work is being done on like advancing developer tools. But we still have, like we talked earlier, 30 years of already existing software that if you only rely on source code, you can't fix it. And there's no way we're going to rewrite every piece of software that's ever been written for the last 30 years in order to find and fix these bugs. So a hybrid approach has to happen.
Right. So in the competition itself, the competitors had no access to source, right? Throughout the last 3 years, some amount of example challenge sets and things that were used in trials and sparring, at some point we would make a binary available and they could test their lifting capabilities and their entire reasoning system. And then prior to CFE, some amount of the source related to those binaries released so they could kind of go back and see how they could improve their systems with perfect knowledge or however you want to ground truth. But ultimately in the competition, they had to perform on binaries, right? But from an advancement of science and where can the next levels of science and engineering go, the corpus that was created out of CGC is perfect for this. Because in hindsight, now all of the binaries that were ever used, all the challenge sets that were ever used, have not only the source, but a source, a reference compiled binary. So like when you're writing papers, you want to do comparison analysis, you have a reference already built. Reference polls for functionality. reference POV to demonstrate vulnerability. And this is for all of the challenge sets that have been used. So the data set could be used to assist. And I know that in academia, there's already been 3 papers at least published, and 5, I think, that are reportedly in submission that are already using the data set, even though it's not really a citable resource. So it's encouraging to see that go forward.
Hey, I was wondering if you could speak a bit more about the infrastructure design decisions that were made, both with respect to the environment that the teams had to do their analysis in, as well as the Decree emulator, maybe that's fair to call it, hypervisor, not really sure, OS thing, environment.
Can you run through that one more time, please?
Yeah. I was wondering if you could speak more about the environment that the teams had to operate within, both about the environment that the teams had to run their analysis software inside of, and also the Decree environment, how that was implemented, and perhaps what rationale went into that.
So the environment that the CRS ran in, I didn't have access to it, but it was just a Linux environment, and they could kind of do whatever they needed to do. It was a large rack of equipment. But they could do whatever analysis stuff they wanted to do there.
High density blade, about 2,000 cores. We got the numbers here, right? 64 node systems, 2 Xeons per node, 256 gigs of RAM per node, 2 1 terabyte hard disk storage per node. I don't remember how many cores that worked out to. On the order of 1,000 or more cores.
Yeah. Now, the Decree environment itself was. It's the 7 system calls, x86, 32-bit, and then we limited certain instructions to get rid of entropy from the outside world that we couldn't monitor at the system call boundary level. So that's the reason we got rid of instructions like reading the timestamp counter that generates a SIG ill. Let's see, the performance counters, the reading random numbers, RD-RAND, those are caught and generate illegal instruction traps. And in the qualifying event, each binary was run by itself in a virtual machine. So it was a Linux running under Xen, and then each challenge binary was run one at a time. In the final event, the competitors had to deal with the fact that there were a set of binaries or a set of challenge sets being run all at the same time, so they had to deal with resource contention. And there was a finite amount of memory in each machine. So that made for interesting trade-offs. And we did see where competitors would, when they exploited a competitor's binary, would jump to an EBFE, a loop forever. Just to consume the CPU resources, and it was also a cheap way to kill the program.
So you can see how some of these design decisions where we wanted to take away instructions forced us into using a hypervisor of some sort, and we sort of made a risk evaluation that we didn't want to take an off-the-shelf hypervisor because it was going to expand our attack surface by a significant amount. So we did custom hypervisors on Linux and FreeBSD. To be able to gain control over these instructions, limit entropy. The removal of entropy led to the introduction of the random system call, which was the only source of randomness available to the binaries, but it was a source that we controlled because we seeded the PRNG that fed the random numbers back up. And I think that's about it.
Okay. Yeah. No, the POVs ran.
You might also note that the POVs themselves, they ran on Decree, so when the competitors put together their proofs of vulnerability, those were programs, executables, that ran on Decree and they ran on the same 7 system calls. So what that was sort of limited what they could do in the way of putting together their POVs.
Thanks.
A few titles left.
So when I was getting started reversing the binaries from ZGC, I noticed that the executable entry point is 0xBAAAAAA. What's the significance of that? Or is there any?
So,
I didn't notice that.
What you're saying is that the initial entry point for the decree binaries was
Yeah, I am.
I think we were just playing around on an ASLR system and we pulled out the stack address that had happened to load in that first binary and we...
That must be it.
Yeah, there isn't also the string embedded into the file format called the Merino, the best type of wool available.
We can neither confirm nor deny.
Come get a book.
Given this was the first year that this competition was held and these systems are going to be competing at DEF CON and eventually the real world, have you considered writing challenges that will actually exploit the systems doing these checks? So that, because people are going to write eventually Trojan horses for this in the real world, just something to consider.
So something that we did see with inside of the competition. So we know that there's a lot of very common existing tools that people will analyze this. So if you played in DEF CON CTF, the number of times that Wireshark O'Day has been thrown to attack the people playing the game is, I think, every year for the last 5 or 6 years, Wireshark O'Day has happened. So with inside of the competition, all of the competitors had to agree that they wouldn't exploit the other systems, but there's nothing to say that if you're analyzing that with inside of IDA, if you broke IDA's analysis, so IDA's analysis was wrong, that's totally okay. And we actually saw that. So one of the competitors, Thompson, why don't you talk about what Deep Red did?
So we were talking earlier about that hypervisor and Jason's masking of the CPOAD instruction to return a constant value all of the time. Deep Red fingerprinted our hardware during our trials so that they could distinguish between our hardware and, say, a VM running decree environment. And so what they put together was a honeypot that used execution divergence. Down one path, they would go to the honeypot, which was a very simple, easy-to-find buffer overflow. The other path led to the service itself. And actually, several teams fell for the honeypot, fell for it hard. They had working POVs. They were scoring. They saw the honeypot, and they said, oh, let me go here instead, and stopped scoring against Deep Red. Unfortunately for Deep Red, they also had some errors in their deployment code and ended up crashing their honeypot services quite a few times. But it was a fairly novel and interesting thing for them to do, and it was fairly effective against quite a few teams.
Cool. This is sort of the CTF spirit of things, right? So leaving some of that in the event, right? Allowing them to poke at the analysis tools without allowing them to try to subvert the infrastructure on which the tools were running was a trade-off to provide a CTF feel, because it is attack and defense. You do have opponents in the game. We didn't want them to go down that rabbit hole of saying the easy win here is to go own the infrastructure, right? We wanted people to build software analysis tools, right? But, you know, and to try to demonstrate that in a CTF environment. So there were trade-offs about how we, the rules that we implemented in the game.
Yeah, and a very important part of our final event was this idea of consensus evaluation. I mean, we all hear about, like, I patched this bug, and then somebody opens up the patch in IDA, and they find that the patch was bullshit. It didn't actually fix the bug, or in fact, it made it worse. So a major component of our final event was the idea that we wanted people to be able to prove that these patches made the systems better. So there's trade-offs to that. And one of those was this potential for having your analysis system impacted.
Thank you.
Book. The last book.
We have a question.
Understanding ECMAScript. If you want it, it's yours.
So we have a question that came in remotely. They want to know, for all the panelists, what's your favorite color?
Black.
So tie-dye, obviously.
All.
And I think...
kind of an off-white, roughly a wool color, maybe. I must say we had no relations with that entry point. This is speaking personally, not as members of a government program.
So I missed the start of the panel, so it might have been answered already. If so, I apologize. But a lot of undecidability results come from encoding programs in the program. Did you have challenges that were essentially an interpreter and then, for example, a constant bytecode for that interpreter where the vuln was in that constant bytecode? And you can imagine nesting that arbitrarily deep. I'm curious if any of the analysis systems could analyze the embedded interpreter, and if so, how deeply embedded it got.
So in both CQE and in our qualifier and in the final event, we had effectively small scripting engines and small emulators. There was a handful of challenges that had JIT-like things in the final event, and I don't believe any of those were solved in the final event. The small scripting engines did have vulnerabilities, but they were standard vulnerabilities in the engine itself, not in the interpreted bytecode.
I see. So it would be like the bytecode instruction had the error, not the not the code for the interpreter.
Right.
Okay. Thanks.
To repeat what Dustin, one of the organizers for this past DEF CON CTF, there was a emulator built into the CGC framework that they used, and the CGC CRS found and exploited that vulnerability. And with that, we are done. I'm sorry, Peter.
Thank you.